Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining us today. My name is Vera, I'm the marketing coordinator at Delmic, and I'm here today with Toon. Toon is our main specialist in cathodoluminescence. He also has quite some experience with time-resolved cathodoluminescence since he worked at Albert Pohlmann's research group at AMOLF. And in a few moments, he's going to start the presentation. Just before that, I would like to welcome you to ask the questions in the question box. Toon will make a short pause in the middle of the presentation, and also at the very end of the presentation, he will also spend some time on answering the questions. So feel free to ask anything that you want. And I'm going to pass the word to Toon right now.
Okay, welcome everyone. My name is Toon. I'm a product manager here at Delmic, and I'm responsible for the cathodoluminescence systems that we develop and produce. And today I would like to talk about time-resolved cathodoluminescence imaging. And this is a very rich topic. And so there's a lot to be said about it. You can talk for hours about it, but I will try to give a more general overview about this. And I would like to acknowledge some people before I start, in particular Sophie Muret, Magda Sosola Garcia, Eric Kieft, Hans Seilemaker, and Albert Pohlmann for their contributions to this talk. So I will briefly introduce cathodoluminescence during my talk, and then I will talk about the properties of light, dynamics in materials, how you can do time-resolved CL imaging, and then I will show some examples of that, and I will end with some conclusions. And so cathodoluminescence imaging starts with electron beam excitation, and this electron beam can be the electron beam from an electron microscope. And during this process, a multitude of different signals are emitted from your material, one of which is the emission of light. And this is what we measure in cathodoluminescence, and in particular, the light that is emitted from the ultraviolet to the infrared spectral range. Now, cathodoluminescence is interesting because you can study optical properties and material properties based on the light detection, but with the spatial resolution that comes from the electron microscope. And so you can study these things at the nanoscale. So let's look a little bit at the properties of light. And so light is a transverse electromagnetic wave, and it's schematically illustrated here. And light has an amplitude or an intensity, and which is related to the amplitude of this electromagnetic fields. It has a wavelength or energy, which is associated to the spacing between these maxima. It has a wave vector, which determines the direction which light is propagating with the velocity c. And it also has a polarization, which describes in which plane these electromagnetic fields are oscillating. And all of these things you can already study in cathodoluminescence imaging with our system. And so you can do intensity mapping, you can do spectroscopy, angle-resolved imaging, and polarimetry imaging to get a handle on all of these properties of light. If you're interested in that, I refer to some of our earlier webinars where we also discussed those things in more detail. But in particular, these properties of light, they're not static, and things can change as function of time. And so there is dynamics associated with light, and also with light emission in particular. And so can you learn about that in cathodoluminescence? And the answer is yes, if you do time-resolved imaging. And so we'll dive into that topic now. And so in nature, and in particular in solid-state materials, there are a lot of different processes that span different timescales. And there's a huge range of magnitudes in which dynamics occurs. On the fast timescales in the attosecond and femtosecond regime, you really have molecular dynamics, molecular switching, hot carrier emission and thermalization, and for example, plasmon dephasing. And if you go to the intermediate time ranges, you become more sensitive to the diffusion of carriers, electrons and holes through materials. And as you move towards slower timescales, you can also see fluorescence and phosphorescence. For reference, a single optical cycle at 600 nanometer wavelength is 2 femtoseconds. So that is just for reference. These processes here, the plasmons, the fluorescence and the phosphorescence, they directly correspond to light emission. And so that's something that you can measure. In fluorescence and phosphorescence, they have strong links also to other material properties, such as the carrier diffusion. And so it's very interesting to look at those things. Typically, if you look at how do you detect these types of processes, then there are two ways. You can either directly detect the dynamics with ultra-fast detectors, but the red time resolution of those detectors is limited, and so you can go below, you can go to sub-nanosecond resolutions, but much further than that, you can't go. And so beyond that, people typically resort to pump probe detection schemes, and I will also come back to that a little bit later. So let's look a little bit more at how dynamics occurs in an incoherent CL process. And so the excitation of a semiconductor in the cathodoluminescence or geological material, for example, these are all incoherent cathodoluminescence processes. And in that case, the electron, it excites your sample. And during that excitation, you promote electrons from the valence band to the conduction band of your material. And after a while, this excitation decays with the emission of a photon. And this process is stochastic, and so it does not have a well-defined time, but it follows a particular distribution in time. And this is an exponential distribution. And so if you repeat this process many times, you will retrieve this exponential probability distribution, which is shown here. And so after excitation, you will see an exponential decay of the light with a characteristic value, which is known as the lifetime, which is the 1/E value of this decay function. For more complex systems, the decay can be multi-exponential, and so there's more than one exponential decay visible. And in that case, you can describe your decay process with two or more lifetimes. But yeah, this is a key quantity in time result experiments. So I would briefly like to discuss Fermi's golden rule in this context. And so Fermi's golden rule describes the decay process describes the decay rate or lifetime for a two-level system. And it's a quantum mechanical description, but I want to show it because you can nicely map it onto material systems, and it shows what things are important. And so let's go through that. And so on the left side of this equation here, you have gamma E, which is just the inverse of the lifetime. This is known as the decay rate. Then there are some constants, which we ignore. And then there's this mu factor here, which is the transition dipole moment. And in essence, this captures all of the material properties. It contains the properties of the transition that you're looking at. And you can translate that into composition. What is the composition of my material? Are there defects? What is the crystal structure, etc.? And so the lifetime is very strongly linked to these material properties, and it can be used to learn more about those. And you can also use it in this context as a metrology tool or as a failure analysis tool or quality control tool. Then there's a second factor here, which is maybe a little bit less well known, but very important still. And this is the local density of optical states. It's a quantum mechanical entity number, which describes the number of available states for the photon to decay into. And so the higher the number of states there are available, the faster your emitter will decay. And so a vacuum also has a local density of optical states. And so if you have an emitter in vacuum, it will emit light, because there are the states available for the light to emit into. But you can engineer this quantity by engineering the dielectric environment. And in nanophotonics, this is done, I would say, very extremely, maybe even, with plasmonic structures, as you can see here. in an antenna geometry, and that this strongly enhances the local density of optical states, and thereby greatly increasing the radiation efficiency and reducing the lifetime. And you can also do the inverse. You can also suppress the local density of optical states with photonic crystals. And so the lifetime is intrinsically is very strongly linked to this local density of optical states. And so you can also probe the local density of optical states if you know it. I want to mention that in some materials, and so for example, a semiconductor nanowire, both these things are very important. And so the emission is very strongly dependent on the material properties. And so what is the carrier diffusion like in this material? What is the band edge of this material? But it's also very strongly linked to the three-dimensional optical geometry of this system. This is a resonant structure. It has waveguide modes. And those things, they modulate the local density of optical states. And so in some of these systems, both these aspects are very important. So in order to study dynamics, it is very useful to have a pulsed electron microscope and analogous to a pulsed light source that you use in optical microscopy. And there are several ways to achieve that. The first one is named electrostatic blanking. And there you have a continuous electron beam, which goes through a set of capacitor plates. And there's a time varying potential on these capacitor plates. Where you have a voltage signal that goes from high to low. And when the signal is high or low, the beam is blanked by an aperture. But during the transition from high to low, the electron beam sweeps across the aperture. And this generates very short electron pulses with a frequency that is determined by the frequency of your potential variation. And this you can just create with a pulse generator, for example, and it has been successfully employed in time-resolved cathodoluminescence experiments. Then there's a different approach, and this relies on a laser. In that particular case, the electron gun that normally emits the electrons has to be cooled down to the point that it no longer emits any electrons. And so it's completely dark from that perspective. And then the laser pulse gives the last little nudge to release the electrons. And this also creates pulses that are on the order of the laser pulse width, typically a little bit longer, but they're still normally on the same order. And this creates very short electron pulses with the repetition rate of the laser. And one nice aspect of this is that you can also send the laser to your sample directly for a pump probe experiments. There's a third possibility, which is maybe a little bit more similar to the electrostatic case, but rather than creating an electric field that deflects your electrons with a pulse from a pulse generator and capacitor plates, you actually use a resonant radio frequency microwave or terahertz cavities. And so that's an alternative approach that has also been under rapid development recently, and so might also be a nice solution to create a pulse electron microscope. So the most common approaches are still the electrostatic and the laser triggered case, and I briefly wanted to discuss some of the advantages and disadvantages of those. And so the electrostatic approach is flexible and simple, and it allows you to very easily switch between a pulsed electron microscopy and a continuous. It is not as fast as the laser, and often the electron optics has to be tweaked in the sense that you have to change some of the condenser lenses settings, and also maybe some of the apertures have to be replaced by smaller ones to ensure a fast or short pulse. For the laser triggering, you have a very short pulse in principle, particularly if you use a femtosecond laser, and it's perfect for pump probe experiments, but you do require electron gun control, so you have to cool down your tip, and so it's difficult to go from continuous to pulsed and vice versa. It takes time because this cooling down and warming up, it is a slower process. And because you require an optical table and a femtosecond laser and light encoupling, this system is much more bulky and complex to operate. Yeah. Finally, I want to mention that in all pulsed electron microscopy experiments, you have to compromise between the beam current that you can have, the time resolution that you can have, and the spatial resolution that you can have. And so for every experiment that you do, you have to find an optimum between these three parameters. And so this is important to realize. So this was, the general introduction. So let's now move to some more practical things. How do you actually do time-resolved cathodoluminescence imaging? And so you have an SEM, either pulsed or not. And inside you have a cathodoluminescence collection, which is done by a parabolic mirror, which you see here. It is connected to a motorized stage, which you can use to align the mirror, and also can be used to retract it if you want to do other things. And then outside there is some optics in the spark detector unit. There is a spectrograph, which you can use for spectroscopy and also for angle-resolved imaging or conventional cathodoluminescence techniques. And in this optics compartment, there's also a place for a fiber module. And this allows you to couple the light into a fiber and guide it towards an external detector where you can do a time-resolved imaging. So this external detector unit is called a lab cube. The light comes in here at the input from the fiber, from the electron microscope. Then there's the possibility to filter it with either and on intensity and with color. And then the light goes to a single photon detector. And this single photon detector is normally a PMT, for example. And this is a very sensitive detector that records single photons and gives an electrical pulse when it does. And these are sent to a time correlator, which is a sensitive piece of electronics, which registers these photon events and also assigns a proper delay to that, a time delay, with respect to an incoming trigger. And this trigger, it typically comes from the pulse generation process in your electron microscope, very similar to time-resolved photoluminescence imaging. And if you run this experiment at a high frequency, you will repeat the same experiment many times, and you can build up a histogram of events. And in the end, this will allow you to reconstruct this exponential decay that I mentioned earlier in this decay trace, as you see here. And from this decay trace, you can extract the lifetime, for example. This technique is known as time-correlated single photon counting. It's a very common technique to do time-resolved imaging. For this, you have to use a pulsed electron microscope. The faster your pulse generation process is, the better the resolution will be in this decay trace, right down until the moment where your detectors start to be limiting. So you can go one step further and do hyperspectral lifetime imaging. And so in the previous case, we used a single photon detector with a color filter. And you can measure the dynamics for one wavelength, but you can also measure it for multiple wavelengths at the same time if you use a two-dimensional detector. And for that, you can use a street camera. In the street camera, you have a two-dimensional detector, which along one axis can measure time, and on the other axis it can measure wavelength. This can measure lifetimes with a very high spectral and time resolution. And this detector that I show here, it has a time resolution of 12 picoseconds. We have already implemented such a system recently in collaboration with the Technical University of Braunschweig. We're going to use this system for semiconductor analysis, and the first results have already been measured. It's really exciting to see. This project is a collaboration between Delmic, Thermo Fisher, who supplied the pulsed electron microscope for this experiment, and Hamamatsu, who are responsible for the street camera part of this experiment. I also briefly wanted to touch upon perm-probe CL spectroscopy. For that, I mentioned that it's nice to use the laser excitation process. And so you use the laser to make short electron pulses, but you also use the laser to excite your sample directly. And so you can measure cathode luminescence and photoluminescence, but you can also send the two pulses simultaneously. And if you add a delay line in your experiment, then you can tune the delay between the two. And the, with that, you can also have a time resolution, even if you just have a continuous detector, like a CCD detector, which you normally use for conventional CL imaging. It's not an ultra-fast detector, but because you do this probe experiment where you repeat the same experiment many times for a given delay of electron pulse and light pulse, you can still obtain dynamical information with a simple continuous mode detector, like a CCD camera. And so this is very exciting as well. We have already obtained the first results with this as well. It is too much to talk about in this webinar. And so I think we'll probably organize another webinar on this topic specifically in the future. So yeah, watch out for updates on that part. Now there's a brief intermezzo for questions. And so let's have a look. And so the first question is, who can supply electrostatic solution in an SEM? And so I think most electron microscope suppliers, they have a possibility of doing some form of electrostatic blanking. So the experiments that we have done were on Thermo Fisher microscopes, and so they have put quite a bit of effort into this specifically. But I think it's not limited to that. And so inquire with your electron microscope vendor what is possible on your specific electron microscope. Yeah, and so let's see, there are some questions about how to measure the spatial resolution and the time resolution of your system. I think I will come back to that after the presentation is finished briefly. And so that I will come back to, let's see. Yeah, and so the other questions that are there, they are related to this. And so I will come back to that after the presentation. And so for now, then I will continue. I mentioned this LabCube system that we use for time-resolved imaging. And so you can use it to acquire a decay trace for lifetime imaging. But there's also another configuration in which you can use it. And in this case, you rather than using just one single photon detector, you use two with a beam splitter in between. And this beam splitter, if you remove it, and this is possible, then you would just go back to the initial configuration. But now there are two, and both are connected to the time correlator. And this is known as a Hambury-Brown and Twiss interferometer in optics. And it allows you to measure the second order autocorrelation function, or in short, G2, as it is also known. And the G2 represents the probability to observe two photons spaced in time by a delay tau. In other words, it describes how photons are distributed in time. It again relies on time-correlated single photon counting, but one of the major advantages of this approach is that you can measure a G2 with a continuous electron beam source, essentially the same as in photoluminescence. And so that means that you can learn about dynamics in your system without having a pulse electron microscope, and it makes things simpler. So let's look a little bit more closely at this G2. And so there's three characteristic behaviors for a G2 function. If you have a laser or coherent source, a light is distributed in time in a Poissonian distribution, which means that the distribution in time is fully random, and your G2 will be flat. It's one. And this is a way in which you can identify a laser. There's a second characteristic behavior, which you find for a single photon emitter or quantum emitter, like a nitrogen vacancy center or a quantum dot or a single molecule. And those systems, they are not able to emit more than one photon at a time. And so that means that your two single photon detectors will never register an event simultaneously. You can never have two photons that are exactly overlapping in time. And that will lead to a dip in your G2 function, which is known as antibunching. And this is very common measurement in quantum optics. It's almost in every quantum optics experiment that you can think of. And it is used to prove that you have a single photon source. And this is very interesting to study in the context of cathodoluminescence as well, because single photon sources intrinsically are very small spatially. And so it's very nice to be able to access that length scale with the electron beam. And so it is quite interesting to look into this as a research topic. The third behavior that you have is what is known as bunching, and there photons are actually they're lumped together in time, and so the likelihood that you'll measure two photons simultaneously is higher than at larger delays, and this is characteristic for incoherent emission. And so for example an arc light source will show this, but in CL you can also see this behavior, but for a different reason. And so we'll look a little bit more at this, because it is, as it turns out, this is a very useful thing to look at in cathodoluminescence. And so here we are looking at a gallium nitride semiconductor wafer with indium gallium nitride quantum wells. It emits efficiently, and so there's an incoming electron beam, or maybe a single electron, and the single electron is typically has a kilovolt or more energy, and that means that it can excite more than one photon, and so per electron you can have maybe 10 or even 100 photons that come out. And so if you actually look in time, you have individual electrons, and for each electron you have a bunch of photons that comes out. And if you do a measurement, actually what you see is this bunching curve, which directly represents this case here. And this curve is described by this equation here, where you have the amplitude at zero. What actually determines the amplitude we'll dive into in the next slides. But it also has a width, and you can imagine that the emission of this bunch of photons is those photons come out with a characteristic time, and this characteristic time is the lifetime that I already mentioned before, and so you can directly extract the lifetime from this peak. But the nice thing is that you can measure it without resorting to a pulse electron source. And this really relies on the fact that the electron has enough energy to excite more than one photon in a material in a short period of time. And this is something that you don't see in optics normally, because in optics, if you use a laser to excite your sample, that laser, it can only excite one photon for one incoming photon. And so this bunching effect will not be visible. And so there's really something that is that's something that you can get in electron microscopy, and it's very useful. Now let's look a little bit more at the amplitude. And so if you have a low current, then these photon bunches, they're well separated in time. But if you use a higher current, then those photon bunches, they start to overlap. You more or less get a continuous stream of photons. And that means that your G2 amplitude, or your bunching peak, will decrease in amplitude. And that's something that we have measured. And so the lower the beam current, the higher this peak will be. And so if you want to nicely see this effect, you should not use a current that's too high. Now, there are also other things that determine the amplitude. And so I already mentioned the current. The lifetime, in fact, also affects the amplitude, not only the width, but also the amplitude. And so the shorter the lifetime, the higher the bunching peak will be, because the bunches will again be more separated for shorter lifetimes at a given current. But there's also another parameter, which is known as the excitation probability. And this is a probability that goes from 0 to 1. And it describes the probability that a single electron actually excites your material and gives a photon. And if your material is not an efficient emitter, or if your emitter is buried very far away in your material, then it can be difficult to excite it. And effectively, this means that your effective current is lower. And so also a lower excitation probability will lead to a higher G2 amplitude. This is a very technical story, but when you do a measurement, you can actually extract the amplitude and the lifetime independently, and the beam current you can measure in your microscope with a Faraday cup, and that means that you can actually measure the only remaining parameter, the excitation probability, and that's a really powerful thing as well, because you can decouple the electron excitation process from the intrinsic material properties that you have. And so to summarize, with the G2 function, you can measure the lifetime, and you can also measure the excitation probability. And I will show some examples of that now. And so in this case, we look at a nanostructured semiconductor, where we have an array of gallium nitride nanorods with indium gallium nitride quantum wells inside. It's an efficient emitter as well. It has a rich spectroscopic behavior that you can map with hyperspectral CL imaging that's shown here. And so for every rods, you have a different behavior because the composition is slightly different and the quantum well thicknesses are different. And so we can look at this complex structure with time-resolved cathodoluminescence imaging. And here's an example where we look at the excitation probability. And so here we study a single rod. And you can see that this rod is faceted. And if you look at this excitation probability, which is extracted from a G2 map that we scanned with our microscope, you can see that this G2 is actually darker where you have these edges. And in these edges, the SE contrast is actually higher. And so you can see that they are sort of inversely related, where the SE signal is low, the excitation probability is high, and vice versa. There's a clear reason for this. When you have a sharp edge, the electrons are more likely to escape your structure. And that means that the SE signal will be higher, but the excitation probability of your structure will be lower. And so that's a property of the geometry of your facets, not of your of the intrinsic material that you have underneath. And so this pattern is due to the excitation process that you have. And so if you actually look at a cathodoluminescence intensity map that you measure in spectroscopy, then you see this faceting and these edges come back in the intensity map. And you can correct this with the G2 map. And if you do that, you can actually see that this pattern, it disappears. And so that means that this intensity variation that you see here is a geometrical effect that's related to the electron beam excitation, and not to variations in the material itself necessarily. And so because you can decouple these things, that is really useful. You can do this without any knowledge of the structure itself. And so there's you have to have no knowledge of the geometry, or you don't have to make a destructive crosscut in focused ion beam milling. You can just do the time dynamical experiment with the G2 and obtain this information without any knowledge of your system. And that's a very useful thing in many nanoscale experiments in cathodoluminescence. So as promised, you can also measure or extract the lifetime. And you can do this both with G2 and also with the decay trace imaging. And in the decay trace imaging, we used this pulsed electron microscopy with an electrostatic blanker that I discussed before. You can also see that in that case, the secondary electron image is a little bit more blurry, and that's because the spatial resolution deteriorates somewhat compared to the continuous G2 imaging case. But you can still nicely resolve each of the arrays, and so the resolution is still far superior to any optical technique. Another thing that I would like to mention is that the lifetimes that you extract and the signal to noise ratio that you get is higher for the decay trace imaging compared to the G2 imaging, and that's related to the detection method. And so in this approach, in the decay trace approach, you use a single detector that detects all the photons. In the G2 case, you use two detectors that both have to register an event, and that is less likely. And that's why the process takes longer. But the benefit of this is that it is simpler from the electron microscopy side, and you can also extract the excitation probability. But in the microscope in Amsterdam, we can do both simultaneously. Or not simultaneously, but in the same system, I mean. Yeah. So with that, I've reached the end of the presentation. And so I gave a brief overview of the developments in time-resolved cathodoluminescence and what are sort of the different directions you can go to. And there is a range of techniques available already, including the decay trace imaging, either with a single photon detector or with a streak camera. You can do the G2 imaging, which you can do also with a continuous electron microscope. And you can do prompt probe CL if you have a laser excitation. I want to stress that the examples that I gave were really just examples. And so the technique can be applied much more widely than I showed here. And so I already mentioned that you can look at quantum emitters. That's very interesting. But you can look at a wide range of other materials as well, phosphorus, ceramics, geological materials, you name it. All of these things you can study with time-resolved imaging, and you will get a new type of information, new type of contrast from doing that. And so, yeah, you can really gain insight into the dynamics at the nanoscale, way beyond what you can do with optical microscopy. And that is very important with the ever-shrinking technology that we have today. And so with that, I will conclude. And I will again look at the questions. Also, if you have any more detailed questions, also feel free to contact us at info at Delmic, and we can also organize a phone call or a meeting to discuss things in more depth if you like. So let's look at the questions. And so there's a question on the street camera. And so we have integrated the system in the software already. We're in the process of doing so. And so this solution, it will be fully integrated. So you can read out and control the street camera from our software. For pricing, we can discuss that personally. And so we typically don't do that in the webinar format. Let's see, are there any other questions? No.
As Toon said, thank you very much for joining us today. And again, if you still have any questions, please contact us at the info at Delmic or at my email, and I will forward it to Toon. Thank you again for joining, and have a nice day.